And still no ding. I'm never going to get used to that. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Holy Crap, the Vlogcast. Vlogcast that comes from a skeptical point of view to answer some of the questions of why. The Vlogcast started as a combination of spite and the Streisand effect when people on Facebook that I knew didn't like being told, you're doing facts wrong. Part of this is also to follow through with the old adage that sometimes the journey is more important than the destination. I'm your host. I am known as Shujin Tribble. You can find me all over the internet under that name. Welcome to the show. Let me introduce you to the abridged version of the crew temporarily tonight. We'll see how this plays out. From up in the hinterlands that are currently on fire up there north of the border, almost. Good evening, Dallin.
Yes. Thankfully for myself, I am several hours south of this particular calamity, which is actually being billed as the worst fire in northern Alberta ever. It's not pretty.
Yeah, so long as you're staying, well, as much as everybody can stay safe in the moment.
Where I am, we're relatively safe. We're doing our best up here to help out people. I see lots of places where they're collecting money, collecting objects, all that kind of stuff to try to help them out.
Very cool. Yeah, and we'll end up briefly mentioning one of those particular items. Chris, we are on the air, and you are popping, so whatever you can do at the moment. From Ontario, just north of me, good morning, Heretic Woman.
Good morning. Thankfully, we do not have anything on fire.
So it was a good start right there.
All the black flies would put it out.
Yeah.
It's not quite warm enough for black flies. Well, although today, I was able to go out in shorts and flip-flops, so there is that. Yay!
I have to work in compression stockings, so I don't have that luxury anymore.
Oh, sorry.
Right. From the
Good morning, all.
Yep.
Good morning.
Right. From the Midwest of the U.S., good morning, Bridget.
Good evening, everybody.
That's right, it's evening for you. What are these days, time zones? Joining us a tad tardy, but still with us, good morning, Chris, from England.
Good morning, Shiji.
And over down to France, good morning, Joseph.
I'm not sure he's there.
Wakey, wakey, Joseph.
Yeah, well, Joseph was also not feeling real well. So we'll see how this plays out. And we'll see if he rejoins us momentarily. And also, from just south of me into Pittsburgh, good morning, Joey.
You just gotta spring that shit on me, don't you?
You're the one.
Hi, everybody. My name is Joe, also known as the local dog collector.
Yeah, I heard about that.
Yep, and it sounds like the mic that's working through for you at the moment is the one on the laptop face itself instead of your headset. But we'll see how this plays out momentarily. It's okay. It can get fixed. Meantime. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Of course, those of you that are watching live, first off, Dom and Trippin' Fool, welcome. Nice of you guys to be catching up with us. Appreciate it.
How about now?
Dom, check your email, dude.
Yeah. And Joey? Yep, you're good. Okay. So, if you are watching live, of course, please, by all means, take advantage of the question and answer system there on the event page here on the Google Hangout. If you're watching after the fact, of course, you can always send an email over to podcast@holycrapthevlogcast.com. Dallin's been very good about converting up a whole bunch of stuff. We'll tell you a little bit about that also in a couple of moments because there's bitchery involved. Yes, I'm making up a word. There's a reason for it. And, of course, if you'd like to live tweet at us while we're on the air at any time, you can send it over to @HolyCrapTV. I was going to put mine out there, but that's really not the one to be using. Anyway, I had a long day out at amusement parks for 7 hours, so I did get some nap time in. I should be okay. And I've got T over here to help me along with this. Anyway.
Poor old bear.
Yeah, poor me. So, with 5 minutes on the clock, with apologies to No Heath and Lucinda, and Eli, because apparently they're raking in money, good on them, your 5-minute freestyle starts now. I titled this one, He Knows. And I'm sure that there are some people that are kind of wondering, okay, we're not talking about Christmas yet, right? Please, not Christmas yet. It's finally stopped snowing, maybe, could be, not sure. With the way that things have been playing out recently, who in the hell knows? He knows. He's not an idiot. Yeah, I'm going to call him out by name this time, because the last time I made references sort of to him, obliquely, I didn't name names, so this time I will. Donald Trump. He knows. He's known all this time, and that's the thing that kills me. Those of you that have been paying attention to the fiasco, the circus freak show that is the American political scene currently, Donald Trump is the only one left on the Republican side right now. Everybody else is gone, and that's actually where tonight's topic is going to end up for the regular show. I don't normally mix these things together, but whatever. He knows full well how he's portraying himself. Who thinks that he's being absolutely genuine? No, he's not. He's playing up a facade, which is about as far as my French goes. He knows. I mean, all these little faux pas. Okay, maybe I know a little bit more French. Get into a relationship with me. We'll find out how much further that goes. He knows these little things, these slip-ups, they're not slip-ups, they're intentional. They're his little finger motions out at everybody. It's like going, it's like if you were to go and shake hands with somebody, and instead of wrapping all of their fingers around yours, two fingers come out and wrap around your wrist to shake hands with you. Now, some people might think that that's a little bit on the creepy side. Normally speaking, I would too. But guess what? That's the quote-unquote secret handshake that I learned as a Cub Scout to identify one Cub Scout to another. And I never thought anything about it at the time, but wow, that is really kind of creepy. Donald Trump knows full well what he's doing, what he's portraying, what he's putting out there. He's not an idiot. All these things that he's been playing up about, oh, Cinco de Mayo, I'm having myself food that's obviously, you know, Spanish in origin. No, it's Mexican, you idiot. And, you know, what the hell? Talking, all the trash talk that he's done to women, misogynistic bastard that he's portrayed himself as. I don't know that he is or he isn't, but what he's portrayed is what we see. So go with that. He's had failed everythings. Yeah, okay, yeah, there's the whole, if you shoot for the stars, maybe you'll succeed, and maybe you'll fail, but at least you'll have tried. Why is this necessarily a good thing? It's not always a good thing. It's good that you try. It's good that you want to go ahead and do something. But if you're only going to go out there and shoot for the stars and miss, how's the expression progress from there? At least that will comfort you. As the heat death radiates out, you lose all of your air, and you die of starvation. Why is this a good thing? He's already gone ahead and earlier this week said that, you know what? We should borrow money to go ahead and build up the infrastructure. We can borrow money at a ridiculous percentage right now, and if it doesn't work out, oh, well, we can just sort of default on those loans. I mean, we can just tell them, look, you don't like the terms, we'll just give you what little we can, and if you don't like it, well, you can just eat nothing and eat the entire thing, or we'll just pay you back what we feel is appropriate. This is the way that you want somebody to operate this country? Really? Don't you think that this is just a little bit of him going, I'm a businessman, and even I know that that's bullshit, and you shouldn't do that ever. Would you ever do business with somebody if they said, would a credit card company take you on as a creditor if you said, you know what, if I can't pay you back, I'll just pay you back whatever little I can, because you'll either take that or you'll take nothing. He knows what he's been doing. The sad part of it is now all the rest of us know all the people that believe him. Makes it that much easier to play whack-a-mole with the people that really need to be whacked upside the head. This is episode number 114 on the docket, Your Honor. I know Kung Fu. This is going to be funny because when I was thinking up what to write for the title, it was, again, one of those few things that kind of came to me while I was driving the company van for one of the last times. Yeah, my company is out of business and I am... Achievement unlocked. Unemployed. Great. So don't worry about it. It's going to be good. We'll see how this plays out a little bit later, but don't worry too much yet. So as usual, we'll touch base. Heretic Woman, I have not seen anything in the news. I have not heard anything come through. I have gone looking and not seen anything. I'm assuming you have nothing yet yourself to hear.
No, I have not heard anything either.
So as of the recording of this show, it has now been 3 years, 10 months, 21 days since Raif Badawi was unjustly imprisoned for thought crime in Saudi Arabia. We are still hoping to hear something at least.
On the good side, we didn't have anyone get hacked to death in Bangladesh this week.
Yeah, you know, small favors there. I mean, yes. It's only been, four this year?
Yeah.
Yeah,
almost... Well, what it is only May, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amazing how that works out. So, there's a couple of things that ended up happening, coming through various news feeds and Facebook social media feeds, which I thought was positively hilarious as hell.
Oh, Shijin, sorry, yes. I'd just like to offer a correction. I've just come across a story from yesterday on BBC News saying a Sufi Muslim's been murdered by suspected extremists in Bangladesh.
Oh, lovely.
Crap.
Yeah, it doesn't give a lot of details, but that was apparently yesterday.
Jeez. Well, lovely. Great.
Yeah. And I didn't... Yeah, I was away most of the day. I didn't watch any news, so my bad.
Yeah, it's only come up in the last... The report's only dated within the last few hours, so...
That would do it. So,
I just thought that news was too good to be true.
Okay, so from now on, I'll just assume that somebody somewhere was killed in Bangladesh for not being Muslim.
Or being the wrong type of Muslim.
Yes.
Yeah, Joey, weren't you the one that was saying just a little while ago the orange and the green?
No, that was me.
Were you? Okay.
Yeah.
Same thing. God damn it. Same. Okay. Yeah. Let's touch that really quickly. The orange and the green. Some people don't get that reference. And there was a. I'm going to show my age. There is an old episode of The Tomorrow People back from 75, 77-ish, which was The Purple and the Green. The idea was that two different factions who were just separated by just a razor's edge of ideology, and they went tooth and nail and... what's a good expression for it? Blew themselves up back and forth? You think, Dal? You think that's a good enough way of putting it?
I was going to go with mad. You know, mutually assured destruction. Yeah, it's... basically, you're tearing each other apart for something that really, it's a curb this high. For the audio version, I'm showing something about less than half an inch in height.
And Chris, it's the difference between Catholicism and Protestantism, and how much of a difference really is there?
Well, there's quite a lot of theological differences, but it gets translated into tribalism, and then it affects who gets property, access to services, jobs, who can drink in, you know, which bars or walk on what streets, and it all ends up as to the good old hillbilly blood feud, where it was, you know, something that someone's great 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 grandfather said to someone else's great 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 grandmother, but no one can remember exactly what. I always think one of the best ways of describing this is from Gulliver's Travels, Jonathan Swift's War Between the Big Enders and Little Enders, being fought over which way up you should put a boiled egg in an egg cup.
Or in this case, here on the U.S. soil, the Hatfields and McCoys. Who cares what the hell started it all? We're just going to kill you all until there's no bullets left in the country to shoot. So who put it over here? Yeah, Trippin' Fool, who put it over in the Q&A. Quote, yeah, there's been a few that have had the misfortune of being on the wrong end of a machete. Ain't that the truth? And for what? For reading the wrong pages differently than somebody else.
Yeah.
It's just... So, yeah, our hearts do go out to these families and people, because it really doesn't matter if it's an atheist, or if it's a Muslim, or if it's a Hindu, or it's a Baha'i. Don't care. Why the hell do you think that enforcing your questionable tactics through the use of a machete is a good idea? Oh, right, it's a good idea because you're not the one that's on the wrong end of the machete. Brilliant, I see how that works.
Well, I think of that quote from Army of Darkness. Good, bad, I'm the guy with the gun.
Yeah, that's true.
That's, in that case, that's the ultimate morality right there. It's not a question of, you know, what's theoretically right or wrong. It's a question of who's going to pull the trigger.
Yeah, the old
golden rule. As that sounds.
He who has the gold makes the rules, boy.
Yeah, the cynical golden rule, we should add.
Yeah, well, just be that as it may. And by the way, hi, Beth. We hope that you're doing well. We've been very interested, and I hope that you're doing good. Mm-hmm. So, the stories that have been going on, and this is where it's been real interesting. The sideline one is a graphic that's been going around that says that all of the people from the Republican camps that were involved with prosecuting President Clinton for marriage infidelities had themselves all now been disgraced with marriage infidelity claims and
funny that
such. Yeah. Now, unfortunately, I didn't get the opportunity to research into that one because, hi, remember me? I was out all day on roller coasters and stuff, which was great, by the way.
I'm jealous.
Although, you know, there's a good chance that, you know, a truckload of throat lozenges has been going around to all of these people so that they can get some relief from choking on their own irony.
Yeah. Irony. Irish. Wow, I was getting worried that I was going to have you edit this out. Okay, good. Irony, yes. Pleuroseptic. I'm sorry. You get the word.
Anyway. Oh, no. Man.
We'll explain that one of these days on a Power of 10 episode at the heat death of the universe. So the one that really got me is that another one that said every candidate who has said, I'm running for president because God told me to, has now washed out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's freaking hilarious. And I think, even if we're not going to talk about the U.S. political scene specifically for that, why the hell do people keep following along people who invoke that time and again everywhere? Because why?
Allow me to answer that question with a question.
Oh, crud.
No.
I don't want to do philosophy this time of day.
No, okay, it's not philosophy, it's... Okay, it's maybe a little bit of philosophy, but I'm going to throw kittens at you, okay? Why do cats always fall for the same damn laser pointer trick? I'm pretty sure it's the same mechanism that drives these people to suddenly get behind. You know, a candidate says, God chose me? Well, the evangelicals are going to flock to that like, you know, the world's greatest fish bait.
I was just thinking God needs to get his omnipotence checked at the, or his omniscience checked at the next hospital, perhaps.
You know, actually, God's just trolling.
Yeah. There we go. I think there's great biblical precedent for this. I mean, how many times did God announce to one of the, you know, patriarchs or prophets in the Old Testament, you know, to go and take the promised land, and only to have them either fail or to lose it after 5 minutes?
You know, that is a good point. Going back,
you know, it's time and time again that, you know, God says, you know, go and be king or leader of this land. Mm-hmm. And in the end, they get 400 years of slavery or something instead.
Well, then there's the opposite, the other end of that. Yeah, I remember the stories that you're talking about. Moses was told, take them down there and go through the desert and go that way, and you'll lead them into the land of plenty and milk and honey. Oh, by the way, you're not going to live to see it.
You're going to die before you can get across the river, yeah.
You won't get there, but everybody else will.
Well, there was something along the line that, like, he was supposed to get in, but then he did something. I can't remember all of Exodus, but
yeah,
messed up in the third quarter, and he was washed out from the game.
Yeah, that's pretty accurate, yeah.
But, you know, kind of getting back to the whole election thing, I am a little disappointed. I'm actually quite... I was expecting a lot more chuckles to come out of a certain individual's reaction to Ted Cruz not making it. And that is the wonderful wingnut that we know as Glenn Beck.
Yeah.
Now, to hear him go on and on about how Ted Cruz was the candidate appointed by God to run and win the election and everything, and what happens? Cruz washes out. Mm-hmm. Beck's reaction? All the Americans are going to hell, and that's it. Like, come on. Where's the Chernobyl-grade meltdown here, folks? I wanted to see this guy's head explode. I wanted some scanners action, man.
Wow. Wait a minute. You referenced scanners. You referenced Chernobyl. Jeebus, man. I mean, how far into the 80s are you going to go? I thought that was my domain.
Hey, look. A couple more months of all the stress I've been going through. I'm going to look like Reed Richards here pretty soon. I got the starting of the wingtips.
Yeah, Dylan. I'm with you. I would have expected, you know, all these candidates told by God to run from the president, aborting their campaigns to have caused more reaction.
Yeah, I wanted a series of sound bites from Glenn Beck so good that Tom and Cecil from Cognitive Distance would, like, practically have to go to the hospital from laughing too hard.
Breaking a rib.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it was the perfect setup, and Glenn, you let us down.
You know what it is? He's not inhaling that chalk dust anymore. That's what it is. He's got no chalk dust.
But, you know, it could also be that maybe I'm setting the bar too high. I've been watching a little bit of this Swanson fella, Mr. Happy Faces on the open sores of all the gay people.
Oh, my God.
Even though all the gay people don't have open sores and nobody's carving happy faces anywhere, no matter how icky they are.
Sackcloth and ashes.
Yeah, so I mean... And didn't he say he was going to cover himself in feces and run around or something like that?
No, we're not going to do that. No.
Whatever his pink is.
Yeah, you know, look, whatever you want to post on FetLife, buddy, that's your business. But forgive me if I just skip over that particular page.
Yeah, you know, even yeah, no, I can't.
Uh, We're too far away from a power of 10.
On the advice of my lawyer, I am voting my right to not incriminate myself by saying shut with my mouth because dumb.
Yeah. To provide the much needed segue at the moment, I have to yell at, you know, Heretic and Dallin for a moment.
Uh-oh.
Go ahead.
Excuse me?
Yes?
We don't know.
You recognize this?
It's hard to say. They all have the queen. Oh, a quarter. Okay.
Okay.
To say they all have a queen on one side.
Damn, 7-Eleven gave me one of these instead of a regular. I got 50-some cents in change. Give me one quarter. Give me one.
25-cent piece if you want to get pedantic about it.
Do you realize that in Canada we have, like, probably a quarter to a third American change and no one cares? We just use it the same?
Well, I've had a few people actually give me, fluff about, you can't use this here.
Actually, I think in the States it is illegal. But
I believe so.
Yeah, but then again, you know, I may not be a complete expert on American currency, although I do know you guys have $2 bills. But I might want to review the actual documentation as to kind of shrugging your shoulders at using another currency. I mean, up here, well, okay. As you guys know, last weekend I was at Shift to Reason.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a 50-50 draw going on there for, to win a little bit of cash, as well as a $200 gift card from Tramps Comics, which would have been nice. And I went to open my wallet, and all I had in there was a handful of American bills from when I'd been in Pittsburgh just a few days before.
Uh-huh.
And the guy looks at my wallet and goes, okay, here. I had, I think, $7 American.
Mm-hmm.
He slides to me a 10 Canadian. He says, oh, that's a fair exchange, don't you think? I'm like, dude, I can just go up to the ATM. No, he says. Just give it to me. And of course, then I turned around and gave it right back to him to buy the 50-50 tickets, but
yeah,
it was awfully nice of him.
Yeah.
But no.
No, the only time.
Sorry.
No, I was just going to say, the only time it's ever a problem is if you get the newer vending machines that take the coinage on weight instead of, like, size. Because the American coins, I think they're copper-centered or something, and the weight's off. So those will spit them back out. But the older vending machines...
Some of the older vending machines won't take the newer currency because it's too light.
Exactly. Exactly. But, yeah, for the most part, no one here cares whether you give American or Canadian. Bills, they care. But coins, no one cares.
Direct, I would say that your quarter is about about a tenth of a millimeter less in diameter, but
Our coins are smaller, but our balls are bigger.
I would have laughed if somebody gave him a toonie instead.
yours also lacks the nice metallic ping that ours do.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you'd stop thumping them on people's foreheads, maybe you'd get a better sound out of the damn thing.
Well, if they stop making such wonderful noises.
Well, yeah, if you're thumping them on people's foreheads, I don't think the ping you're hearing is from the coin. I think it's from.
Well, seeing as none of their eyes have rolled back and revealed the word tilt, I think I'm doing okay.
So that happens, though.
This is your exchange rate talk for the night. Thank you for being with us. The Motley Fool will be on later for NPR, whatever the hell it is.
Now I know that I'm getting old because I know there's some kids out there that when they see this video on YouTube, they're going to have no idea what I'm talking about.
Yeah, and I was going to make a joke about putting it into the circuit box. Melt the whole damn thing down. Anyway. So, all right, yes. People are going ahead and they're saying that I'm the one, so follow me. And then other people go ahead and say, "No, I'm the one. No, I am Spartacus." Okay. what are we supposed to do? How are we supposed to take any of these people seriously? Or, more appropriately, how do we allow these people to be taken seriously long enough to hang themselves without endangering everybody else?
Well, if I may.
Go right ahead.
I wouldn't say it's a cult of personality, but it's the celebrity thing. We get to live vicariously through others' achievements. And, you know, if we happen to play some small part, such as giving them a vote, oh, we helped! We were part of that!
Yeah, I can go with that.
It's equal amounts of self-importance and yet self-unimportance, because you're trying to live vicariously through this person, and yet, what are you doing?
But I have a question. Why do our candidates get worse and worse?
Because it's just like kids and their parents.
Well, you know. I thought 2012 was bad. 2016, oh my God.
I managed to get away with this. Now, next time, let's see if I can get away with a little more, and a little more, and a little more.
Well, listening to David Silverman a while back, I still have that. If you have Atheist TV, you can actually still go back and watch this. His opening speech for, I think it was the American Atheist Convention in 2015. And he talked about when he went to CPAC. And even Seth Anders has said, you know, he is a Republican, and he is now asking, where's my party? I think the reason the candidates are getting worse and worse, at least on the GOP side, is because they've gotten, there is a group of hardcore religious right type people, the Tea Party and other groups like that, that have wormed their way in and have now become sort of the public-facing side of the Republican Party, and a lot of Republicans are actually scared to say anything about it. There were people that came up to Silverman at CPAC and said, you know what, I'm actually an atheist, but if I let that be known here right now, I'm in big trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Like, apparently, believe it or not, Sarah Palin actually had pull in the Republican Party.
Yeah,
I know, it's frightening, but it's because she had sort of the Tea Party backing and everything like that. That's why you see all these whack jobs out there, is because they have the endorsement of that one extreme right faction of the Republican Party that is the most aggressive and sadly the most charismatic. And that's why. Or that's one theory I have anyway.
Yeah, as an aside, I'm sorry, one second real quick. As an aside, Trip and Fool, who's listening, had also put in something in the Q&A, a link to a Mother Jones article, which, by the way, Mother Jones, I've got my own issues with her specifically, but it, be that as it may, the headline on it was, Ted Cruz is dead. My son ran for president after God sent his wife a sign. This one was dated from February 22 of this year. And said, in part of it, quote, my son Ted and his family spent 6 months in prayer seeking God's will for this decision. Okay, first off, why 6 months? Wouldn't it be just an easy thing for the great divine to just go ahead and say, oh, by the way, here's the message, and I'm sending it to you on the leg of a snowy owl. But, anyway, hold on to that. Continuing. But the day the final green light came on, the whole family was together. It was a Sunday. We were all at his church, First Baptist Church in Houston, including his senior staff. And then they went on and they basically go on to say, you know, it was a great thing. It was a great moment. It was the face of God. So, I'm glad I didn't see the face of Bo on that. That would have been so much more entertaining for me. It was there, and it was time, and we were ready to go because we had the divine ready to go with us. We had Mick in our corner, and he didn't have to cut us. We're going to go ahead, and we're going to take on Ego Drago, or Ivan Drago, whatever the hell his name was. You know, and it's like, what? See, I can do the 80s references. There you go. And, you know, it's a great story, but when all is said and done, I don't know. It just all falls apart for me. It's crazy. I'm sorry, Chris, for interrupting you, but I just wanted to get that out of there because it's like, drives me up a wall.
I just find it, you know, amusing how, in all instances, it seems that the Almighty has absolutely no choice but to operate through hearsay.
Yeah.
Funny. Yeah, Chris, I hope I didn't completely derail your brain.
You have, don't worry. That wasn't hard.
See, it's not really my job, but I'm so good at it. I guess I got way too many things running through my head, and none of them are appropriate right now. This is really, really bad. There's a T-shirt out there that said, "My brain is comprised of 90% song lyrics and 10% miscellaneous stuff." Right now, that's what it's feeling like because I've got stuff going through my head. I've got an epic rap battle of history going through my head. This is not a good night.
Yeah, believe me, I know how you feel. Considering I am the repository of all useless knowledge. I can sit in front of a textbook for hours and try to, you know, learn something and absolutely, completely forget it the next day. But you put me in front of an episode of Family Guy for one frickin' time, not even fully paying attention, and for some reason I've got it word for word.
Yeah. Now, you see, if they ever do a Cheers reboot, Joey, you should apply for the part of Cliff Clavin.
Joey, can I just test you that? So what is the word?
Oh, haven't you heard?
I've not heard, no.
It was my understanding that everyone had heard.
Get your hand on that mute button right now, Tribble.
Not the same.
I see what you did there. How? Stevie Wonder saw what you did there 2 weeks from now.
I'm going to go on record as saying I hate you all. I really do.
Okay, you want to talk about, obscure information. You know, at least he didn't smell that joke coming from a mile away.
He has no sense of smell either.
Will you stop picking on the man?
You brought
you started it.
Yeah, but at least he actually is... He, like myself in some of my regards, has the self-awareness and confidence to be able to laugh at a joke about at his own expense, even make a joke at his own expense. Like, you know, when W decided to wave at him.
So...
Okay, but that's W we're talking about now.
Yeah, we'll come back to that later. So there's the big rub right there. It's a joke. It's a long-running joke that we've all had to watch from this side of it. And the worst part about it is they don't even recognize the joke. They don't see it. They don't see it for what it is. They can't see... You know what? I just suddenly realized. The human condition, one of the big things is we see patterns where there aren't. There is an actual technical term for this. Anyone...
Pareidolia.
See, we know what it is. And I put it out that way because these guys know it because we've run across it multiple times before. That's not a word that you easily remember because it's not a word that you normally run around with. But you should know it. Kind of like the same way that you should know Dunning-Kruger effect. Which, by the way, the best part, the first rule of the Dunning-Kruger effect is you don't recognize that you're part of the Dunning-Kruger effect. References on top of references.
This one's going to turn into a reference drinking game at this rate.
I don't care. You know what? People get drunk. I don't care. Maybe it'll be more fun at that point. But we see patterns even when there aren't patterns. We piece these things together just because of the creativity that's inbuilt in us, because who only knows exactly what the mechanism was for, although we've got some pretty good ideas. But what is it when it's the opposite, where you can't see the pattern even when it's there over and over and over and over again?
Ignorance.
Insanity.
Yes.
Ostrich effect.
I think there's also a Latin term for it, too. It's called head upus urasus.
Keep that in mind.
I thought that was rectal cranial inversion.
I like that one better. I'm going to use that one at some point.
Yeah. Bridget, you're the one of us that actually understands the medical side. As far as the idea of somebody's mental acuity not being able to properly process where they are, who they are, where they are, you know, the traditional, you know, you just woke up from being passed out. Do you know who you are? Do you know who's a president? What year it is? You know, that kind of thing. What is it when somebody fails these otherwise simple tests to find out, are you actually going on in there?
No, you're not oriented to place, time, or person.
Can you? I know it should seem to be like a simple enough thing, but I'm kind of wondering, can somebody be basically held on to, maybe not right the right expression for it, for their own safety, if they don't have that, they're not oriented, they're not otherwise dangerous, but they just don't have anything, they can't put stuff together.
I mean, can they be involuntarily committed? Is that what you're asking?
I guess that's probably the best way of putting it, yeah. I would assume that the answer is yes.
If they're no harm to themselves, no.
I suppose the most appropriate term would be detained.
Yeah, if they're no harm to themselves or others, then legally, no, not more than 72 hours.
No, it's like somebody who's got a cognitive delay or something, they don't just lock them up. They give them a chance to live amongst everyone until they become a danger to someone.
Yeah, but, just having amnesia is not enough to do it.
No. Because if you don't know who you are, you can still function in a capacity, and you could decide, hey, guess what? I don't care who I was. I'm now going to be Bob and carry on from here, you know?
Or like I'm hungry and I can beat myself.
Yeah. Hey, what do you know? I know how to flip burgers. Hey, this is good. I can get a job.
Could be worse. See, yeah. The reason why I'm kind of bringing that up is that, like I said, this thing about follow me because X said so, it happens so often, and has happened for... Wow, the religious angle has really been pushing in the U.S. since the 50s. I mean, huge. Being a big, big, big piece of it all.
Well, I mean, you look at Jim Jones and the following he had.
Oh, geez, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what? I need to...
Mm-mm. Sorry.
No, that's okay. It's a quiet joke. People have to watch on the video to get that joke. But if it's been happening time and again, easily in politics, and probably stuff like this has been happening through the ages, as far back as there's been places for people to say, hey, I've got a bigger stick, but I've been commanded how to use it. There's got to be a point where people finally just say, hey, you know, this guy said it, and he was wrong, and this guy said it, and he was wrong, and she said it, and she was wrong, and Well, it's got to be right this time, right? Isn't that the term for insanity? Expecting a different outcome from the same.
Look at all the doomsayers out there. The people who said, you know, the end of the world, the rapture is coming.
Harold Camping.
Okay, our most present day one. But go back, like even in so-called biblical times, they were expecting him. They were expecting Jesus to return. You know, even like what was it, 50 some odd years after he supposedly died. And so what is it? It's those mental gymnastics again. It's that trying to conform the world or trying to interpret something to fit why something didn't happen that you were so certain was going to happen. I can't wait for some of the gymnastics that are going to come out about the whole election thing.
Because, like, with Camping and that, you know, the first time it was, oh, well, that wasn't, like, the rapture. That just means, you know, I forget what his excuse was, but it was something like...
It was a spiritual rapture.
Spiritual, yeah.
Yeah.
And then that means that, you know, if your spirit wasn't raptured, then you might have another slight chance. And then the second time, it was like, oh, well, now that means that was closed off, you know, and now it's like the real rapture's the next one, and yeah.
Yeah, and we all know Randy Savage took it all for us anyway, so...
Yeah.
You know what? I just realized something. If this was a spiritual rapture, doesn't that mean that all the people that were raptured, all their spirits are now gone and they're all meat puppets? They're all zombies, and we don't realize it yet. This is freaking creepy.
So I guess it is the zombie apocalypse. I guess we all better get to Jim Baker's website and order some of that potato soup, huh?
Oh God, no! Oh no!
Hey! I'm living alone right now. I could probably do with some new furniture.
Brilliant.
You know, I could use a new coffee table.
And by the way, the guys over there are Scathing Atheist. A, good luck on the move back to New York. B, I would love to contribute money to you guys that you have to buy and eat and document what that crap tastes like, but I've got problems with my own.
I think Camping may have been right. More than half of my spirits have been raptured.
I am the way, the truth, and the light. And the only way through me is through the liver or something like that.
Was that Jim Beam?
No, Jura Scotch.
Okay.
Oh, jeez.
For those who are not privy to the video currently, that was formerly a large bottle of spirits that is looked like there was less than a quarter left of it.
Yeah. Kind of reminds me of this joke. A wino goes into a liquor store. He says, I want to return this bottle of wine. I didn't like it. And the guy says, okay, as long as not too much has been taken out, we should be fine. I only had a mouthful. And he hands the bottle over to the guy and looks at it and says, wait a minute, there's nothing left in there's hardly anything left in this bottle. I thought you said you only took a mouthful. Well, I got a big mouth. And Heretic Woman, that joke I actually saw done as a skit on Royal Canadian Air Force.
Oh, farce, yeah.
And the wino?
Yeah.
David Broadfoot.
Oh, jeez.
It's the same guy who gave us such a wonderful line as, give me a quarter for a cup of coffee or I'll breathe in your face.
Yep.
Sorry, little Canadian humor there, folks, but you want to talk references, Sujin? We just hit a couple from the 70s there.
Okay, yep. That's good. That's fine. That's fine. That's great. That's
fine. The only thing is that it's pre-chicken cannon.
Oh.
I love me some chicken cannon.
Yeah, for the rest of you, just go on YouTube and you'll see what we're talking about.
The only chicken cannon that I know of came from Adam and Jamie.
So I don't... Yeah, no.
No, this one's a little bit different.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, Air Force chicken cannon. Look that stuff up. Yeah.
Just remember, you're supposed to thaw the bird first.
Not in this case.
No. And, yeah, bird didn't happen all that often either.
No, that they saved the birds for the New Year's episodes.
Yeah.
All the other stuff is just, yeah.
Yeah. You gotta watch it.
God, as my witness, I thought turkeys could fly. Okay, so we've come to realize that a lot of the people in the Republican camp tend to be highly religious. The highly religious tend to believe that science cannot be trusted. Well, isn't science a collection of documented tests on the world to find out how things work, and then re-referencing back and double-checking and quadruple-checking and continuing to check and making assumptions when those checks keep coming back consistently in order to make new assumptions and generate new tests for new stuff going forward? That would sound... I mean, would anybody argue with that idea so far? Nobody?
Not here.
No arguments at all? Okay, good. Now, with that in mind, if people consistently say, I am the one guy and you should vote for me and I'm the one that's going to make everything work the way that it's supposed to, and consistently, these people consistently just fail consistently, and you can document it and you can write it down and you can put it on celluloid and you can put it into a newspaper and you can put it into a spreadsheet and a database and reference it back and forth on pieces of videotape. Why don't these people believe in science? Because the science keeps screwing them over every time. There seems to be a running gag here, doesn't there?
But children, you see, there's this book.
And besides, were you there?
Yeah. Chris, England has got some of the greatest, best-known universities, colleges, places of learning, places of research, some of the greatest explanations of stuff that was going on. Why should the English-speaking public be so dumb in some areas? It seems wrong. Shouldn't England have spread better-thinking people? All right, granted, yeah, Australia. But, I mean, besides that...
Well, it depends on how you look at it, and who we exactly went over to found the U.S.
Yeah, the people that even the stuck-up, straight-laced aristocrats said, you guys are a little bit too...
religious.
Yeah, and...
You're taking the whole thing too far. And doing it wrong.
Yeah, that says something right there, doesn't it? Oh, we want to get away because they think that we're too stuck up. And they're right. God, really? So the science keeps showing it over and over. The documentation shows it over and over. I mean,
and then
if
you look at the people that we sent over to start Australia.
They were contacts.
Yeah, and then if you look now at, see... Let's see which country is turning out better.
You mean between between
the US and Australia?
You know, Joey.
Too harsh, maybe.
He's kind of got us there, doesn't he? That doesn't work on audio,
you know what?
Man.
You know what? I can say this much: there's a lot less wildlife trying to kill me.
Yeah.
But they didn't put it there.
At least my mammals know when they're mammals.
Look, we all know that, look, the platypus is just simply evidence that God can get stoned.
I was going to say that it's evidence that he has a sense of humor, but...
Sure, yeah, we'll go with that.
Well, you know, let's take a beaver. Put on a duck's bill.
I mean, clearly, you know, he has to have a sense of humor. I mean, he managed to prank a lot of guys into cutting off their foreskin, but...
Yeah. A lot of guys?
Well, yeah.
And what's this past tense stuff?
True. Yes. You know? They are still doing it.
And it's not just the whole cutting off the part. It's the fact that the other guy then has to, like, go down on the person afterwards.
Yeah.
You know, because it's, you know...
When you say person, you mean baby.
You know, I'm not a big fan of that in the first place in either respect, but, you know, having it be bloody at the same time is just kind of ew.
And as somebody else put that I saw recently, what do you think the guy that had to circumcise Jesus was thinking at the time? I mean, that's not... I don't know. That's not a job that I would have wanted. Thank you very much. Yeah. No, actually, let me re-qualify that. That's not a job that I want. That's not a job I want anybody to have.
Like, we talked about Jesus' circumcision on our show, I guess it was last week, and Katie said something to the effect of there's 4 or 5 different churches that claim that they have Jesus' foreskin right now.
So does that mean they chopped off a bit too much, or...?
I'm wondering. Maybe that's why they're saying that he couldn't have been with Mary Magdalene.
I think at that point it's not exactly circumcision.
No, it's a something ectomy, I think, at that point. But either that or he had one of those magically regenerating foreskins.
Oh, so he was Wolverine. Okay, that makes perfect sense. I'm gonna
Wolverine foreskin.
I'm gonna piss off a whole bunch of Roman Catholics and Italians, and I really don't care hearing about that particular item. Calamari.
Oh.
Why won't these people... See, okay, now wait a minute. You've actually unintentionally brought open a different piece.
Okay.
We've got the foreskin of Jesus, but so do we. We've got pieces of the actual cross, and you can buy the slivers of these pieces of wood for $13.95 plus shipping and handling.
Oh, yeah.
From 13 different groups.
It must have been, that cross must have been as big as the foreskin.
There's a wood joke I really don't want to...
It does kind of make me wonder then, if that's the case. I didn't know they grew sequoias in Jerusalem.
I've heard that there's a few places that claim they have the nails too.
Yeah, there's enough nails and bits of wood around to build like a warship.
Yeah, okay. You mean like an ark, perhaps?
Ooh. Oh. Ooh.
Yeah, but I don't know if it's go forward or not.
did you see some fool in Holland actually built one that floats?
Yeah.
And, like, hoping to have it towed to Brazil.
Yeah, no. Yeah, he in his own video, he made out that it was going to be sailed over to Brazil.
Yes.
It was an authentic recreation of the Ark, except for the cinema and the dance hall and the bar.
And then
the news report said, in order to get it to hold together, they had to put in an iron hole.
Yes.
On there and structure. And also, even so, they still can't get the thing to be seaworthy. So they're going to have to put it on a big barge to carry it across the Atlantic.
Oh, wow. Hold it. Time out. Doesn't this qualify under the technical term of, and I could be wrong on this one, spoilers, because cheating?
Only all of it, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, but as, and I posted about this on my wall, and I basically said, Ken Ham, you're doing it wrong. At least theirs is in frickin' water. His is in the middle of Tennessee on a giant cement foundation. Actually, a building stuck on one side.
Yeah, to that, though, I have a question. Are there any, like, good lakes in Kentucky that we all know about?
I don't know.
Don't know, but
basically... No, no, no. Not for floating it. That's not what I'm thinking. I was listening to...
impersonation?
You mean thinking?
No. I was listening to a show, and they were talking about, when the Ark Encounter opens, and, projected sales, like ticket sales and stuff. And the fact that because it's not really a museum, because you're not going to be bringing in anything new, eventually it's going to dwindle to the point where it's going to become this gigantic eyesore.
Yes.
And, someone will probably end up having to take it off AIG's hands because they won't be able to afford to keep it up.
Yeah.
And like, okay, so what could it become?
If there's
a lot of, lakes and stuff around, I'm thinking it could be the biggest bait and tackle shop in the good old state of Kentucky.
Nope. Put it on a flatbed, ship it out to the East Coast, and rent it out. Get the next cult who wants to go ahead and kill themselves and make it the biggest Scandinavian ship fire pyre for everybody dead that you've ever seen.
I was going to suggest the world's largest Long John Silver's, but hey.
I like that one too.
I was thinking seafood restaurant.
Ooh, better yet, Red Lobster. Because then they won't be able to eat the shellfish. They're going to hell.
And if they do, you can just sit there and go, aha!
I think the Church of the Flying Spaghetti Monster should step in and take it over.
Pirate ship! Fly a Jolly Roger on that puppy.
This is not a Power of 10 episode. Cut that. Oh, right. Yeah.
She said puppy. Hello? Relax, dude.
What did you think I said? Clean this, your ears out,
this
bud.
This is you that we're talking about,
Hey!
Hey, she resembles that remark.
I could swear my face off on my own show.
Yes, and you do.
Yes, I do.
But wow, that is actually a really cool idea. I know this isn't exactly right where we were looking at going, but I'm sorry, I'm taking us down this rabbit hole. That would be freaking amazing if we could get the Church of the Flying Spaghetti Monster to be like a large enough. Oh, I'm sorry.
Pastafarian wedding cruises.
No, it doesn't have any propulsion on it. But oh my God, here in the U.S., a prison inmate was basically told in Nebraska, I believe it was, that Pastafarianism ain't a real religion, so we're not going to accommodate you for stuff that you want to do, like reading and having religious garb to wear, like a colander or a pirate outfit. Oh, would this not be the ultimate F you to the federal government of the United States of my America to say, hey, look, we've got a lot of people we pulled together. We went ahead, we bought this out from under this scumbag. So we've got a real place. This is where our headquarters is now, the same as Church of Scientology's got theirs. So,
yep.
Tax breaks!
And Trippin says that the biggest lake in Kentucky is, get this, Kentucky Lake. 160,309,000 surface acres.
Okay, so probably some good fish in there.
I'm thinking. Safarian.
At least two of every type. Scorpions. And wait, what?
And scorpions.
What are you talking about, scorpions?
When I was a kid.
Don't be talking about water scorpions.
No. When I was a kid. My stepdad took me and my family down. We went to stay on a relative's houseboat, and on the beaches, I found lots and lots and lots of these little tiny red scorpions.
Mm. That's not good.
No, not good at all.
Scorpions are pretty much everywhere on the planet, save for Antarctica.
Okay. We have scorpions in Canada?
Oh, I'm sure.
Only one that are on tour, last I heard.
Okay.
Well, most of the tell you what. If there were scorpions up here, they probably looked around and went, "No, it's too damn cold," and went back down south.
I'll look it up and see what we can find.
I'm pretty sure it was just the big city lights that scared them off.
You know you know that Dutch Ark, it has a giant fake giraffe on the prow. You could have the giraffe holding a Jolly Roger in its teeth.
Let's see. The 10 most dangerous... Aw, really? Of course. Top 10 most dangerous animals in Canada. 404 not found.
Would there be a cached version, perhaps?
There might be, and I'm sorry. If you're gonna put the Flying Spaghetti Monster stuff on that particular giraffe, there should be a comic bubble right next to it that says Brie. Some people will get that reference. Yeah. A lot of people won't.
Yeah.
There are approximately 1,500 species found worldwide. An estimated 1,000 are, as of yet, not described. Throughout tropical and warmer regions, the northern and
boreal, are
the only species known to occur in Canada, namely southern Saskatchewan, Alberta, and British Columbia.
Alberta.
So yes,
not in Ontario.
There are indeed scorpions in Canada, and not the ones on stage.
Yeah, they're your way, Dallin. So you can keep them.
Mm. Well, maybe with my luck, they're all being burned right now up north.
That's how they're trying to get rid of them. The same way that they burned down an entire house to get rid of an infestation of spiders in New South Wales. They're just getting rid of all the goddamn scorpions.
Yeah, you know, when we say kill it with fire, we shouldn't be trying to take that literally. Just saying.
Yeah.
What is this?
Because Fort McMurray is burning rather horrendously right now.
No, I know of this, but what did I just find? Are you kidding me?
What?
The Historica Canada, also known as the Canadian Encyclopedia.ca.
Oh,
the hell, people!
What?
Yeah, we got lots to stuff that people should know.
Yeah, like how much free space there is out there where it's, you know...
Trump-free?
I was actually going to say where the internet runs very slow because it's hard to push the electrons through those really cold cables up there. And lots of little lake islands.
Probably, yes.
Yeah, if you're in Manitoba, you'll see a lot of that.
Mm-hmm. But I was going to say, what Joey was saying, some of the scorpions have yet to be described. I'm like, it's a scorpion. Aren't they? They sort of have a similar look.
I.e. specified by species.
Okay.
Okay.
Because what I was thinking is, like, you have your black scorpion, your red scorpion, your brown scorpion, your clear scorpion, your white scorpion. WTF, 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 WTF.
Yeah.
It's like, what the hell is that?
It's the Scottish tartan plaid scorpion.
I'm holding money to see that.
Yeah. The only thing that I want to know about
it stings with an accent. Good brogue.
Yeah, the only thing that I want to know is, does it have a good attitude or a bad attitude? That's all I care about.
Yeah, I guess it would. Yeah.
Maybe you have like an actual native Canadian scorpion that after it stings you, it apologizes.
Yeah.
It could, but if it said it's from Alberta somehow, I'm not holding up very much hope for that.
Oh, thanks.
Nothing personal.
Screw you too, Treble. And no, I'm not fixing that in post.
No, I would expect
you'll add some to it.
Yeah,
you probably will. All right, so the all right, back onto the topic finally, because I'm don't get me wrong, I love when stuff like this ends up happening, but yeah, we do actually have a show to finish. All right, so before there were proper elected positions of power, whoever had the biggest stick won. And, of course, into the Middle Ages, the guy with the biggest stick was the guy who had the biggest army and the biggest castle and the best way of delivering munitions somewhere. And thank you so very much for the telescope for that. We appreciate that.
Up until the Turks showed up at Constantinople.
No.
I ain't got nothing to drink.
No. Not. No. Joe, no. Not doing it.
What? I'm just referencing, what was it? Mehmed the Great's use of artillery?
Okay. Okay, that's fine. That's not what he was doing. He's trying to screw me over. I know it. Anyway, so you didn't have very much in the line of trying to figure out who was in charge other than who had the power, who had control over the land, ergo who had control over the people who controlled the land. More specifically, who controlled the people with the big sticks that controlled the people with the smaller sticks that controlled the land. Feudalism, etc., kingdoms and such. And then the Roman Catholic Church mucked around with stuff. And they went ahead and they dictated on many an occasion, we're going to tell you who's going to be in charge. And you want to be in charge? You need to make sure that you're good with us. Which included, you know, money and influence and treaties and bullshit.
Yeah, blessed by God had an asterisk next to it.
And that was, as memory serves, yeah, Chris, that was one of the reasons why England didn't particularly care for the Roman Catholic Church anymore and kicked their asses out.
Yeah. one of many reasons.
Well, can't imagine why. Oh, right, because the king wanted to get himself...
Yeah.
What's the expression?
Stub. Divorce. Laid.
Yep. Yeah. Which is, of course, the nice way of putting it.
He wanted a little something outside of the something he was getting, or not getting, as the case may be, and yeah.
To be fair, it was all about political alliances and whatever, so at that point. Yeah, so unfortunately, they've maintained a presence here ever since, and which is a shame.
Well, unfortunately, like, it's... No, go ahead.
In, like, old history, like, I remember taking a course on this years ago, and the general, what I got from it was, back in the day when England and France were, you know... what was that term you used earlier, Shujin, of beating the crap out of each other?
Close enough.
Yeah. But ultimately, one nation couldn't go to war with another unless the Vatican said they could. And if the church wanted to exert pressure on a particular nation for something, could be a larger show of piety or something like that, all they would have to do is say, you know what, you're going to do this, or I'm going to go tell, you know, England that they are cleared to come down here and kick your ass again.
Mm.
At which point the French went, okay, we'll listen, and vice versa.
Mm.
As a matter of fact, okay, I might be butchering history here, but Pope Innocent III, who was Pope at the time of Prince John, a la Robin Hood. Yeah, he had to step in and school old Johnny a little bit.
Yeah, and if memory serves, not exactly the Catholic Church's purview, but back when ancient Greece was holding the Olympiads, mm-hmm. there was no warfare allowed between the states that were otherwise normally warfaring with each other, because, you know, that's what you did when you didn't have iPhones. And you didn't do it.
No.
It was just an accepted peace, and I don't remember if it was just negotiated because or from whoever the Oracle at Delphi or whatever, whoever soothsayer it might have been.
But there was also compulsory attendance between all the city-states, and there was one case where Sparta declined, and they were fined heavily.
Do you know why they declined?
No. I
allegedly, it was because in the wrestling competitions, a rule had been instituted saying you are no longer allowed to gouge your opponent's eyes out. And so,
well, that's just no fun.
That's what the Spartans said, you know. you're just making the sport too soft. We're not interested.
Okay. That part I didn't hear, but I know that there was an instance where they did decline, and it actually did come back and bite them in the ass.
You're like, hey, that's the only reason we participate in that sport. Damn it, screw you.
Wow, and now we're worried about juicing and doping and red blood cell packing. Okay, yeah. No, I'll decline, thank you. I like having a really out-of-shape body and not having to worry about participating in these things with other nude men, thanks, no.
Oh yeah, don't forget, the original ones, everybody was naked.
Yep. Yeah, and it was all guys, too, because, you know...
Yeah.
Well, let's be... You know,
well,
what?
Same goes for their theater.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the theater usually weren't nude. Usually.
No, but female characters were still played by male actors.
Yep. Oh, yeah, that was the same way in Europe for centuries.
Yeah.
Yep. And Japan also had the same, as I recall. So, Neither here nor there. So where I was looking to kind of go down was science collects the information, and you can reference it, and you can look it over, and you can redo it, and retest it, and check it all out. And you go by that, and you realize, it's all been bullshit all this time. It's all been a stack of lies. It's all been wrong every time. It's been easily... You don't have to work really hard to put these points together. And yet they go ahead and they have the Ark Encounter tour. They've got the Creation Museum. They've got of pandas and people, and completely trying to say the science doesn't work. What do you think would happen if we were to finally go ahead and collate all these over the last 100 years and show definitively the facts? Remember, not capital T truth, because don't do that anymore. The capital F facts, and yes, capital F in some people's cases could be something else, but Nick isn't on the show this year. What do you think the reaction would be? Other than, of course, the ostrich maneuver.
I think you just answered it right there. It would be the ostrich maneuver.
A whole lot of la 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 la, I can't hear you, la 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 la.
Yeah. And the people that you're directly, those who are still alive, who you'd be directly implicating in all of this stuff, would come up with, they would either scream persecution, they would, you know, pull out every victim card they had, and believe me, they've got as many victim cards as veteran Magic the Gathering players have cards, period. You know, they have the bigger, blacker box of victim cards.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And there would be a lot of that. And it would work. Another interesting factoid that I found out last week. Even though they were talking about the debate between Ken Ham and Bill Nye.
Mm.
Now, one little tidbit came out of that was that of religious leaders or priests and stuff who were actually asked about this, a whopping 92% of them admitted that Bill Nye kicked Ken Ham's ass.
Yeah.
However, from simple sympathy donations, Ken Ham raised about six figures worth of donation money after he lost, which went to the ARC project.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. And it was just like, oh, you lost, here, have some money.
Damn.
You know, I'd go and lose a debate every other week if it meant I could get that kind of scratch.
Oh, hell yeah. I'd be like, here, come, I will create a forum just for you, and I will lose every damn time.
Yeah, tell you what, Matt Slick, let's you and me go. I'll just sit there on YouTube and pick my nose for 60 minutes while you rant and rave, and I'll collect a whole bunch of money. How about it? Yeah. What do you say?
Yeah.
Deborah, I think that the challenge may actually be finding a way to lose to Ken Ham.
Okay, yeah, you have a good point.
Yeah, then you'd probably get money for, like, I can't believe you pulled that off.
Yeah.
And see, the way that you're describing this, I was going to go looking it up, but I can't type quietly enough. I was just thinking to myself, you know, losing as a profession isn't so bad. I mean, look at the guys that go touring around with the Harlem Globetrotters. They've been losing for 50, 60 years, and they're still doing a good job.
Mm-hmm.
Don't they get a team from wherever town they go to? Usually
like a college team or something like that.
Yeah, I don't think they bring like their perpetual losing team with them. Mm. At least I don't think so.
I'll look it up later, figure it out.
But then when you see those guys play, you realize like I wish the NBA still played like those guys used to.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Globetrotters are actually, I think, a surviving remnant from the NBA's predecessor. And they actually had players that did that kind of stuff all the time.
Oh,
in that league. And I'm like, damn, that would have been 10 times as entertaining as anything you see these days. I mean, if I knew the Raptors played like that, I'd be flying out to watch the games. Hell, even the Grizzlies could have gotten some audience.
Yeah, there's more shots fired. Okay.
Yeah. Well, what are you going to do?
See, it is.
Hey, I'm from Alberta. Screw y'all.
Okay, where are the Grizzlies from? Because I'm curious.
Vancouver.
Okay.
They came around the same time as the Raptors, but unfortunately they didn't do they did okay for a while, but there wasn't enough support or something, and they just disappeared.
Okay.
Screw you. How very Canadian of you.
I like basketball less than I like hockey, and I really don't like hockey, so.
That's okay. And you go ahead and ask him where the Grizzlies are from. I was going to make another Woods joke, but again, can't do that. You know what? I am starting to see a pattern over here. So let me do this. Only one more question on the actual topic, because as far as I can see at this point, we don't want to do this topic. Because it's stupid. It's asinine. It's not something that we can do anything about, and it's not something that's going to change anytime soon because these people are too stuck up in their own imaginary friends thing to do anything about, and won't even recognize it. So screw it all. So how about this? For the last question for on the topic, and then screw it, we'll just throw it open, and I don't care. Have fun at my expense or badmouth me. I don't care at this point. Because it's just...
We've just been too long without a Power of Ten show.
Well, it's coming. It's coming. It'll get here. Same as it always does. Same as it always does. What is it... How do I word it? Because if I'm going to get one last question... You know what? I know what the question should be. Is it going to be worth it? Would it be worth it to actually grab these people, figuratively speaking, We here at Holy Crap the Vlogcast do not advocate the grabbing of people and forcing them to do stuff. Please don't go ahead and do that, because most constabulary people will not appreciate that, so please don't do that. We're not going to take anything for that, and we're not going to go ahead and forward you bail, so tough.
But Comrade Stalin will be very pleased.
Well, he's also still very dead. At least that's the expectation. Okay, so proverbially speaking, is it going to be worth it to actually grab somebody by the scruff of the neck, shove their nose in their own shit, and show them what it is that they've been complaining about and how they're wrong with the actual facts? If nothing else, just to watch their brains implode. And Bridget, I want to throw it over to you first, because you're in the wonderful position of having all these people who are just absolute, you know what, screw it, I don't care, I'm gonna use it.
Indiana is the one who chose Trump. What can I say?
Yeesh.
It was over after Indiana.
And thank you, thanks so much for that.
You're welcome. I don't think that sticking their noses in it is going to do anything.
You know why? Because they like the smell of themselves.
Mm-hmm. Because they're stupid as hell. They don't learn. 2020 is going to be more of the same, if not worse.
Wait.
Yeah, but on the bright side, at least you got 2024 to look forward to, right, Joe? you
want to? Yes, I know. You guys know you want to see me behind that desk. I've watched The West Wing and House of Cards enough.
Yeah, 2024. He and I are both running. Yeah, we're gonna revive a political party from the 40s that Gracie Allen started. It's the surprise party, and we're just gonna go in there. We're gonna take it all on.
Well, in that case, then you know, Dallin, we should resurrect the rhinos that year.
See, I was gonna join the marijuana party.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, but what are they gonna do by then? It's all gonna be legal.
Yeah, good point. So yeah, maybe we should get the rhinos back together.
Yeah.
And yeah, so you and I get in office, Chujin and Joey get in office, we form this wonderful coalition.
Yes.
And we become the US of A. And
yes.
Whoa. Okay, hold on. I'm not sure that we need to be to expand NAFTA any further.
Well, no, we're just going to expropriate you all, that's all.
Yeah.
Look at it this way, then Nick will go back to Australia, he'll hook up with the sex party, and, you know, we'll open up relations all around. I mean, come on, this is going to be great.
We could be the start of the United Federation of Planets.
We could. Eh?
However, I can't say that it'll all be peace and love.
No, we're going to have to turn Kentucky into a parking lot.
Because I'm going to tell you right now, the very first thing I'm going to do when I get into office, I'm going to challenge Kim Jong-un to a game of paintball.
All right.
You do that.
Okay, assuming his doughboyness is still alive at that point.
Oh, no. You know what would be better? Challenge him to a game of hockey, then you can beat the crap out of him into the boards.
Well, you know, I know he likes basketball.
Yes.
But I'm garbage at basketball, really.
No, wait a second. Right. The Heretic Woman's got a perfect opportunity here, because if...
Dodgeball!
No.
Dodgeball!
No. Hockey is better, because if we get the opportunity, and if you are president, you do realize that we have three of the best ever in the game that we can call on. The Hans brothers.
Oh,
jeez. There's a lot of hockey players that could educate him rather well, I'm thinking.
My nephews could educate them.
Yeah.
They were in minor leagues, but he is my youngest nephew. He actually drove Bobby Clark into the boards during an old-timer game.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was pretty epic.
I'd be like, oh, I'm sorry, sir, did I break anything?
Actually, Bobby went up afterwards to him and said, good hit.
Good?
Yeah. Oh, you know what?
To sort of answer the question, though, about, you know, is this all worth it? I honestly think after this election, just, again, based on stuff I've been hearing on the news and everything, is that the GOP, if they get as trounced as we all expect they will be, I will not say when, I will only say if, because the fact that Hillary is becoming more of the front runner, I'm seeing an awful lot of apathy on the part of Democrat-leaning voters. Who really want Bernie, but at this point it's still out of their hands. In either case, if the GOP loses, and if they lose as badly as people are expecting them to, they are going to have to take a hard look at themselves and take that extreme element by the scruff of the neck and push it into that pile of crap that they made to watch their heads explode.
Yeah.
Because really, if you're going to get spanked to the point that you may not even have a voice in the political arena, when one half of your two-party system has imploded itself to the rate that these guys are about to, they have to really take a look at it and realize that, you know what? Going with the religious right, going with the whole God is on our side thing is not working. Mm-hmm. And when you completely and utterly deprive them of any legislative power whatsoever in the country, they're going to find that out really quick, and they're going to have to do something about it.
It's more the reason why I say that we really just need to... Is my mic working?
Yep. It is, yep. Yeah.
Okay, for some reason the pips aren't showing. I've said it before, I'll say it again. I really do think it's time for us to get rid of the whole party politics system. I mean, at the very least, the two-party system. Because, let's face it, the Founding Fathers, when they came up with the whole thing, even they were like, look out for two-party politics, because it doesn't work. And, you know, over time, we developed two-party politics. And sure, it worked out for a little while, but I really think that we've outgrown it. I don't think two parties is sufficient enough for the diversity that is present in our country.
Yeah, and
I was just thinking, if they do implode, like I know here, we have a threshold that a party has to maintain of seats in order to maintain their party status. Is there something like that the Republicans could be facing?
Best of my recollection, no.
Okay.
You do have to, in order to properly campaign and be electable in each of the states, each state has its own thing about how many votes that you get in particular elections.
Okay.
In the general election, I believe it is.
Because I know... Yeah, go ahead.
Yep. If you fall under a certain amount, you don't get recognized and you can't be on the next general cycle.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was saying.
Something like that.
Because I'm trying to remember, Dalline, what year did the Progressive Conservatives implode? And they actually lost their party status for a while.
That was...
I'm thinking like 03, somewhere. It was before Harper was, they reformed it into the current Conservative Party.
You know what? I think that was wasn't that the final tail end of the whole minority government?
Yeah.
Because Harper got in on a minority government, and then Layton and, was it Dion? Yeah, Layton and Dion said, they demand, you know, we want to go again. So Layton would call a non-confidence vote.
Yeah.
And force another election. I remember we had something like 3 elections in a 5-year span.
Yeah.
And at that point, the Liberal Party got absolutely spanked.
I thought it was just before Harper got elected that the original, what they called the Progressive Conservatives, imploded and lost their party status.
Well, what happened was the PCs, or the Progressive Conservatives, they merged with the Reform Party.
The Reforms.
And they became the Conservative Party.
The Alliance. They went with the Alliance because it was Reform Alliance and then Conservative.
Okay.
Yeah, but I'm thinking of a time when maybe it was when Kim Campbell was in, where the Progressive Conservatives did not get enough seats in that election, and they lost their party status for a better part of a year. I want to say it was. I don't know exactly, but they definitely lost party status for a while.
I'm just calling it up here.
Yeah.
Let me see.
Okay, while you're doing that one, hold on to the status when you get it. Chris, as far as the election cycles and such for England in general, how many, best of your recollection, how many major political groups are typically vying for elections at the higher levels?
So we've got, I'll just get the current breakdown at the moment, if you can bear with me a second.
Okay, while you're looking that one up, Dallin, did you find your piece?
I'm just looking here right now. 2003... the party membership voted to dissolve the party and merge with the Canadian Alliance to form the modern-day Conservative Party.
Okay.
So that was 2003.
I knew 2003 was important.
Yeah. I'm trying to find... There was reference to... Let's see.
Okay. You.
Here we go. When Kim Campbell had taken over after Brian Mulroney resigned... That was in 1993. That was the worst election of the party's history. The Conservatives went from being a majority party to holding only 2 seats in the House of Commons, which was not enough to maintain official party status, despite garnering 60% of the popular vote. It was the absolute worst defeat, and it took until Harper became leader for them to even recover.
I thought it was around Kim Campbell's time, so that makes sense.
Okay.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that is the legacy of the first and only Canadian female prime minister.
So far.
She didn't have a chance. She didn't really get the chance to shine.
No.
The way that she should.
And the reason for that, and I don't know if it's ever happened, but when the majority was maintained, but whenever there's a change of leadership without an election, I don't think that interim prime minister has ever been reelected. Because I thought he lost after that.
No, I was saying like Paul Martin.
Yeah, like Paul Martin, yeah. Paul Martin, Kim Campbell, what's his face that was only there for like a month? I can picture his face, but
it's okay.
Yeah, but
wasn't Dion, was it?
No, because Dion was never prime minister. He was like Kim Campbell, though. He was only in power for like a month, and then as soon as the election was called, he was voted out. Damn it, I can't think of his name, but it doesn't matter. But yeah, that's when that happens. What happens is, for whatever reason, the current prime minister either loses the party vote, loses non-confidence, or like Cretchen just kind of said, you know what, I'm retiring. And so the party will have a convention like what you guys are doing now, but instead of picking a candidate, they pick the leader of the party, and the leader of the party automatically becomes prime minister. But once that happens, the governor general has a certain amount of time where he or she has to call a federal election to confirm or replace that non-democratically chosen prime minister. So, and as far as I can recall, any of those appointed prime ministers have never been confirmed later. I could be wrong, but I don't remember it ever happening.
So let's back out for that and see where it got us. So Chris, yeah, the political scene for you guys.
Okay, so at the moment, so our House of Parliament has a total of 650 seats on there. At the moment, so we have the Conservatives for 330, Labour 230, and then Scottish Nationalists 54, and then it's into the group of half a dozen minor parties like the Liberal Democrats, Independent MPs, Green Party, etc., that have got the remaining seats. We have just had a local round of local council elections here as well on Thursday, and both the major parties have lost considerable numbers of local seats, which have interestingly been split between the Liberal Democrats and UKIP, which is our right wing nutters party.
Well, at least there's some in every. It's kind of like scorpions, apparently, all over the world. Just a little bit.
Yeah.
And by the way, Trippin, you're right. I despise hockey, and I'll probably be deported at some point.
No.
Well, look, her name's Heretic Woman. I mean, the heresy's built in.
And to add to that, so I don't like hockey, I hate winter, I hate beer, and I don't like Tim Hortons coffee either, so, yeah.
Yeah, you know, today, just to do my teeny tiny little part for the whole Fort Mac thing, Tim Hortons has now for sale, they call it the Alberta Rose Donut.
Oh.
And all the proceeds from it go to relief efforts.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. They're not bad. I had one, you know, it tasted like a Tim Hortons donut.
Yeah.
But I like what they're doing.
Tim Hortons donuts aren't too bad. Yeah. I just don't like their coffee. Well, I don't like any coffee. I don't like coffee, period. So.
But yeah, I'm seeing all kinds of stuff. Like, I was at the store today. You can make a donation right at the till. I just found out that Sobeys, one of our other grocery stores out here, they're accepting donations of food money otherwise, and all 100% of it goes to... Actually, no. For that one, it's a monetary donation, and 100% of it goes to the Red Cross to help with relief efforts. And then there was the whole band thing that I told you guys about on the Friday night show last night. There's an event planned for next weekend here in town. 23 local bands are going to be doing a type of rockathon, if you will. $10 at the door. They're going for many, many hours. and they'll be accepting donations. And all of it goes to relief efforts for the fires happening up in Fort McMurray area right now.
Good.
So we're pulling together.
Okay. So back on the track of it all. So the piece I was going to go for was... So from what you're describing at this point, Chris, you're talking about an election where you've got upwards of seven groups that could all be vying for some kind of a place at the table.
Well, they've all got a place. They've got places at the table. and as has happened recently, that the two main parties have been so closely split that voice from the other smaller parties really counts. Because we have just, you know, recently come out of a coalition government, so.
Sorry.
The problem is, although it does give more diversity of opinions, it can also mean that there are just simply like more parties to get to agree on something. So it swings and roundabouts whether or not it actually, which works out more effectively in the long run. And so on there, don't know enough about politics to come down either way on that. On there, two-party politics can work if both parties are willing to negotiate and agree and work together on there and make compromises, etc. What you've had in the US is just deadlock because both sides are not willing to actually engage in politics with each other, and so the whole system's been shut down.
Yeah, funny you should say that, because I'm
and the Republicans that. Have got get a lot of heat from this, but say the Democrats have not been above it either.
True enough. I believe the expression is everybody's got blood on their hands.
Yeah, and it's when you get that kind of completely bipartisan entrenched positions and people are not willing to talk and compromise and negotiate in order to actually get the running of the goddamn country done, then that's where you have a problem. And sometimes it can only be solved by, like, going to an election and changing the balance of power. If people are not willing to work together.
Yeah, it comes down to that whole who's got the bigger stick at that point.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's not necessarily the best way of running things.
So we're getting pretty close on to closing up shop, and I'm gonna be closing us relatively quickly, because like I said, I spent all day out. And I can see the red in my face on the camera, surprisingly enough. So I'm a little starting to run down battery power wise. So I think what we should do is just to close out of this. I'm not quite sure if you guys want to go off of the official topic or off of whatever a perspective that you got, because what I want to close with is kind of weird, kind of meta. As usual, of course, you'll see in a minute. I don't know who wants to go off of this. This is, admittedly, this has been a lot of a mashup come the end of it all, because, again, I'll explain when I get to. Bridget, you came off of mute. Did you want to go ahead and start off and kick?
I just think it's funny as hell that the evangelicals have nobody to vote for now. They can't stand Donald Trump. So what are they going to do? Stay home? Some of them are burning their registration cards. Some of them are leaving the party, re-registering as independents. It's just funny.
Fine by me. That's good. That's good.
I think it's hilarious.
They can all vote the Green Party and go with Ralph Nader.
Yeah, I think that's funny.
Just a thought, Joey. You know how funny that particular item is. I was also thinking of Ross Perot, but Ross didn't come out of my mouth fast enough.
Phrasing.
No, I know.
Point being, You know, we've heard the term too big to fail before. Mm-hmm. And we've learned the hard way that's just not a very bright idea. If you want to vote for somebody, or if you want to show somebody support, regardless if they're a politician or in some other form of power, do your homework, please. Do your homework. Make sure that, you know, they are a proper representation of your values, because that's what they are meant to be, a representative. And if they're not, look, the moment you start settling for, you know, who should I vote for, just the lesser of two evils, that's when things are going to start turning real sour real fast. So, you know, do your homework and take an active role. That's the way our system of politics is supposed to work.
Chris, I don't know what you want to throw in at this point. Usually I can read everybody, but I don't even know.
I've not really got anything to throw in at this point.
Well, that explains it. No wonder I couldn't read you at all. It's been one of those nights. So.
Yeah.
So, Heretic Woman, sure.
I think it's kind of funny, too, that the evangelicals have nobody to really fly their flag, so to speak. It would be highly ironic if they started voting Democrat, but I don't think that would actually happen. But I still think that Trump's got some weird stuff up his sleeve that's gonna come out. I think he's gonna, if he, you know, gets confirmed or whatever, he'll be like, oh, guess what, it was all a joke, ha, or some stupid thing like that, or, you know, I don't know. But there's something is definitely rotten in Denmark, is all I can say.
That's also something I've been saying for a long time and really hoping for. But Dallin, go ahead.
Well, just having followed everything, I said before, I do kind of wish there was more of a meltdown on the part of the people who had claimed that God had appointed candidates like Cruz or others, to that they were the ones that were now, you know, chosen to lead America into the next generation or whatever. And now that they have failed, now that all of these claims have been just absolutely refuted, I mean, there's no other way to look at it. A guy like Glenn Beck says God chose Ted Cruz, and Ted Cruz is no longer running. I wish this would, you know, create that crack in the armor of some of these people to say, maybe this faith that I have, maybe this God that I follow, this one that's telling me to hate the gays or to hate anyone not like me or to, you know, say that it's okay to slap my woman around, maybe that's someone I should start questioning, because this guy said that he appointed him, but it didn't work out. I hope that at least one person out of this starts asking the questions that will eventually lead them to, you know, actual free thought. It's a hope. From a comedic side, I do feel bad that, I feel disappointed that we didn't see, you know, the nuclear meltdowns that I was hoping for. But maybe through this, maybe those seeds of doubt will start being planted. One can hope.
So, I'm going to close with something that I don't think that I've ever closed before, and I can't believe I'm about to say it, because, like I said, this is really, really meta. The topic officially was about the people who were religious saying, you know, I'm the one, vote for me. Here's where it gets really meta. We really didn't want to talk about this. We really didn't. we went through a whole bunch of different things, and much more entertaining, much more fun for us to chuckle at and have good word games with. We really didn't want to talk about this. And that's not something that is very typical at all. And why would that be? We who like to talk, me especially, admittedly, I'm really horrible about that. I sit back a lot more than you guys would believe. Sit on my hands virtually. Why didn't we want to talk about this? Because this topic sucks. This topic, this is not even an infuriating topic. This is a topic of just absolute annoyance. It shouldn't even be, and that's what kills me. I mean, I thought this was going to be a great topic to talk through, and admittedly, you know, I've had some good topics, I've had some crap ones. This is not a matter that it's a crap topic. It's a matter that this is a topic that shouldn't have happened in the first place. And it really wasn't supposed to be. I mean, hell, the expectation was to leave religion at the door when you come in to do the government stuff. First Amendment of the U.S. is that's the way it's supposed to operate, but admittedly, that line gets blurred like crazy now. So can we laugh at these guys? Sure, yeah. Let's go ahead and laugh at them, humiliate them. No, that's not worthwhile. Because that's just going to breed more of those, you know, persecution cards. Nobody needs that. The science is the only thing that can really save all of this. But how do you get them to listen to even that part? When they're going to be going off and licking their wounds and being all... Oh, look at poor me. It just... So what do we go looking for? We go looking for the people who have been doing the job, doing it right, following the best ideals, our best ideals, not because of ideology, but because it's the right things. Why can't that be what you're supposed to be doing and actually doing it? Why can't it just be because it's the right thing to do? And yes, I'm making another TV reference. Some people get that. But really, is it so bad? Is it so wrong? You want to get your ideas for how you're supposed to operate from a book? Well, is it any so much more wrong than me getting a lot of ideas from TV and movies? Doing the right thing for some of us who grew up on Star Trek was following through with the idea that people are people. And what's wrong with that? There shouldn't be anything wrong with that. But then you get these other ideas, and it doesn't matter where they're from or how old they are. Do they help or do they hurt? If your ideas end up hurting more than they help, why are you continuing to follow along with that? We go through this talking because... with any luck, people will listen to it and will think about it, and they will come to conclusions, maybe not different conclusions, but better thought through conclusions, and are willing to listen. Political scene over here, nobody's listening. Everybody's stuck on that ideology thing. I want people who listen. Maybe there's something wrong with that, because that's an ideology I don't want to come off of. But tough. My country, my rules. Or more appropriately, it's my vote, my rules. You don't follow my rules, my vote's not following along with you. Am I going to tell you who I'm going to vote for, who I want to vote for? I'm staying out of this. Can you figure it out from what I talk about? If you can't, you're not paying close enough attention. As always, everyone, thank you very much for being with us. Hope that you've found something worthwhile in all the perspectives that we've got. It's always entertaining. It's always enlightening to me to talk through a lot of this stuff, even when I'm not quite sure where it's going to go. Maybe even especially so, because who knows? Well, thank you, everybody on the panel at the moment. I do not believe that you are actually there, but just on the off side, because I think that you've fallen asleep. Joseph, are you actually there?
I'm here now, yeah. I did fall asleep.
Okay.
Sorry okay. about that.
That's okay. All right, so if everybody's ready, we'll... Yeah, I know. So if everybody's ready, we'll just get the show started for Joseph. Are we ready to go?
Okay. What's the topic?
The topic is the use of sleep in getting one into better health.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to be our test bed. Good night. You take better care of yourself, would you please?
I'll try.
Fair enough. I assume that you don't have anything that you should be plugging other than perhaps sleep aids.
Or coffee.
Coffee. Yeah, coffee. Yes, definitely coffee.
Yeah, he's got to get his day started now, doesn't he?
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, sun's just coming up.
Well, good. All right. Well, good luck today.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Chris, of course, thank you very kindly. You take good care of yourself this morning.
Okay, and you, thank you, Shujin.
Trying. Joey, thank you, of course. You take care and stay safe, and good on you on running that down today.
Oh, yeah. Well, all I have to say is right now, NyQuil, we love you, you giant fucking Q.
There goes the tag out the window.
John Delancey appreciates that, I'm sure. Thanks so much. Bridget, thank you for your time this morning, honey. You get your rest, man. You deserved it, man.
I will.
And you can find the musings of Bridget.
BridgetFitch2112.wordpress.com.
Thank you so very much. Heretic Woman, you take care of yourself. And how many shows are you getting to plug tonight?
Three, actually. So, of course, two. Yeah, sorry. I'm used to plugging my show and your show on my show, so I don't have to plug your show because we're here. But there's Beyond the Trailer Park every Monday night at 9:30 p.m. Eastern on YouTube, and you can find out what's going on there and links to use and all of that at beyondthetrailerpark.com. And a week from today, yesterday now, you can also find me on the Atheists of Facebook channel. I was asked to prepare a talk for that, so I will have a speech when they get around to uploading all of those for everybody. I'm not sure how many there's going to be, but mine will be there. So I will provide Shujin with a link, and he can stick that in the show notes. And right now the channel has nice talks from the last couple of... that's called an online conference, so it's kind of like going to a conference, but everybody is just on Facebook and YouTube, so but it's still kind of cool. So I'll provide a link for that, and you can go and listen to my talk, and it's called Banging Your Own Drum Doesn't Have to Be a Solo Act. So that'll be there next week.
Cool. Dallin, thank you very much for your time, and you do and promote yourself, of course.
Oh, pleasure to be here as always. And there is a reason I'm called the audio bitch here. It's because I'm the gatekeeper of the non-visual version of this show, which you can find over at holycrapthevlogcast.com, as well as my own progressively maligned blog as of now. over at robotechtiger.tumblr.com. It's funny, every time I want to post an entry or stuff like that, I start writing, I get three sentences in and go, what the hell am I... Oh, shiny! I thought I was too old for ADD, but apparently not.
That's okay. But thank you so very much for doing all that, man. Truly appreciate it. And you had yourself a great time out there at Shift of Reason. And
I did.
Pictures are available in various locations, of course.
Yeah, they're up on Facebook. I had a great chance to talk with Seth Andrews, talked with Aaron Roth for a little bit. Light casual conversation with Matt Dillahunty. There were several other speakers there. I learned a lot, and there was one particular topic that a local university professor had brought up that I would love to learn a lot more about, because you know how we've always said, or I've mentioned before, we always seem to be dealing with tropes versus tropes. This guy has put a spin on kind of the origins of religion that really perked my ears up, really got my interest.
What's his name?
Damn it, I knew you were going to ask that. I think it was Professor Edward Arnold. Just give me a second here. Sorry for taking so long on this plug here, Shujin. I do apologize. Here it is. Yeah, William Arnold. He's the head of the Department of Religious Studies at the University of Regina. And I'm not talking, this is not theology. This is a guy who is looking at social origins, cultural origins of religion.
Anthropology.
And yeah, okay, I didn't want to use that word without for fear of not using it right, but yeah. Very anthropological view. Usually I'm the one helping out with this. But yeah, a very anthropological view on the origins of religion. Very, very interesting stuff. Something to really get into, I think.
Well, if you can find a link, put it in the show notes.
Oh, hell yeah. I'll get you something. as soon as he started talking, Joseph, I had you in mind.
Yeah, well, that's, I'm really, really into that kind of
thing. Yeah, I think you'd like his work. I will see what I can get for you.
Okay, thanks.
So to go along with all these pieces, didn't check with everybody. I will not be able to stick around because I'm pretty well done for the night. I don't know if any of the rest of the cast wants to stick around to do after show time. We have at least one request for it. So was anybody going to be sticking around?
I'm going to be crashing here pretty quick too, actually.
Yeah, I'm kind of bagged.
Well, I'll stick around a bit, I guess, since I missed the show.
Look, I just spent the better part of half an hour chasing around something that had more legs than I did, so I'm going to have to decline.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, Dom, I'll put the link over to you momentarily anyway, and see how that plays out. Item last. Those of you that have known me for a long time know full well that I will be doing my 36-hour radio stream marathon fundraiser. That's going to be coming up at the end of the month, which is going to put us on the weekend of the 27th, which is a Memorial Day weekend here in the U.S. I'm going to be on the air for actually over 36 hours, almost 40 hours at that point, fundraising for the Ride for Roswell. If you would like to, find out a little bit more about the Ride for Roswell, I will have a link in the show notes for my group, End of Cycle for Sarcoma. Because I don't care that I haven't been exactly keeping up with the not safe for work tag, because the little drops here and there I don't think are really worth it for. But as XKCD best put it once before. Fuck cancer. And there is somebody who is basically my sister in arms who added to that in the eye with a Buick. Cheska, I'm right there with you, hon. Big time. So I will have information about that. Yes, you will be able to listen in on the stream. I am going to have the word out to a whole bunch of podcasters so that they can see about having other people listen in. And who knows, maybe I'll have a couple of folks come on and do a lot of good. I'll have the links out for that. Item last. All of the stuff going on what's the name of it again? Fort Dal.
Fort McMurray.
Fort McMurray.
All right. If you are looking to do donations to any group for Fort McMurray, please double check, because something was mentioned. Please double check that the funds are earmarked specifically for. Some groups, like Red Cross, if you just do a general donation and do not specify, or it isn't through a specified campaign, it will go into a general fund and not specifically for. So whatever thing that you're looking to help towards, just double-check and make sure that you're putting towards specifically. Other than that, thank you for being with us. If you'd like to drop a message over to us, you can drop an email over to holycrapthevlogcast@holycrapthevlogcast.com. As Dallin mentioned, the audio feed is available from over there for your pod-catching devices. And if you'd like to leave a voicemail message, 859-HCTV-554, 859-4288-554. Thank you guys so very much, and I'm trying to be real conscious as to what I'm saying at this point, because I'm really, really running out. But thank you guys very much. The end of the month for that particular weekend, I don't know how it's going to play out just yet. I hadn't posted out, but we'll see if anybody wants to take the reins for the show for that night. We'll see. I won't be able to be part of it because I'll be doing other stuff, but we'll see how it plays out. No matter what, thank you for being with us. And if you do want to be part of a brief end of show, get in touch and we'll see what we can do about it. But otherwise, thank you. And of course, my wife. We're almost 11 years on and I'm still in love. Matane Fujin, I love you and I miss you. Dream of me. Till the next time we get together, everyone, as always, good night.